One thing that's, I think, fascinated me, though, about the benefit of exercise. So exercise also has a really nice, powerful benefit on sleep, although it's a two-way street, and remind me to talk about right. that in a good way. But something else has occurred to me with saunas, too, and I was thinking about this because I think I know that you're a fan. I think you've mentioned yeah. this before. One of the ways that you can induce sleep is that you can increase a lot of the immune factors, things like cytokines, you know, things also like TNF-alpha, you can, or BDNF.
IL-6.
IL-6, yeah. IL-1 even more so, but IL-6 is part of that equation too. And we've known this for some time that if you infect an animal, it will create an immune antibody response, a cytokine cascade. Those cytokines have a direct communication pathway into brain structures, including things like the hypothalamus, which regulates sleep. And it's that immune cascade that is actually a trigger for dialing up the amount of sleep. So when animals get sick, just like when humans get sick, the thing that you want to do is just curl up in bed and go to sleep. And in fact, you get sleepier
yeah.
as a consequence of being infected. Why is that? The reason is because there is nothing better. Sleep is the Swiss Army knife of health, that no matter what the ailment,
oh, that's so cool.
I didn't know. There is something more than likely in the armament of sleep's tools, toolbox, sort of as it were, that will deal with that. And so, and I promise I'm not going off on a tangent here. So the idea is that these immune factors are sleep instigating. They are
this is awesome.
Sleep sort of, you know, they're somnogenic, uh-huh. you know, somnus, sleep, genic, increased genesis improvement. So what I've been thinking about is whether or not the sauna, the benefit of the sauna, is both thermal.
Yes.
But is also by way of this powerful immune pathway.
It does.
That
it,
you get this.
That's
I've read some of the studies, and I'm blanking on his name. You will probably remember his name. That has they've looked at the sauna induced immune responses.
Yeah. So that Charles Raison's been doing
you,
that work.
Yeah,
yes.
Thank you. Brilliant. Yeah. So I've read some of Charles's papers.
Yeah. We had him on the podcast. He was talking about how the sauna induces IL-6.
Yep.
And some of that stuff, and the same thing that happens with exercise.
Yes. So that's why I mentioned exercise, right. Which is that I think...
Wow, that's so fascinating.
So now we're all starting to sort of, you know, realize how the sleep system is augmented. One of those paths, you know, is light. The other is darkness. The other is temperature. But here's a fourth one, the immune system. Mm-hmm. And we know that you can inject, you know, some of these cytokines into animals, and you can almost induce sleep. It's that powerful.
That's so cool.
So now I'm starting to think, I wonder if some of the sauna-based benefits and some of the exercise benefits, because when you exercise, you also typically get right. some of these pro-inflammatory cytokines that sort of get released to perhaps deal with some of, you know, the essential, the stress. And, you know, I think we've both spoken about this, that...
Is that why, if you're exercising a lot, you do seem to require more sleep, or you sleep more?
We don't know that, but that's my current theory, which is that, you know,
Are you going to test that? That's awesome.
Yeah, we're going to test it. So we've just actually been looking at a study, not with exercise or with saunas, but we've actually been looking at sleep and pain. Mm. And when you deprive people of sleep, you get a chronic release of these pro-inflammatory cytokines, which is not a good situation. Acute,
right.
great, somnogenic, good for the body, but chronic long-term. And we're starting to piece together a brain-body-sleep-pain interaction, which I think has... We haven't published this yet, but should have marked implications for the hospital environment, because the one place where you do not get a good night of sleep, where it's architected against the night of sleep, is the one place where you need sleep the most, and it's usually the one place where you are in pain the most. And I want a revolution to happen regarding sleep in hospitals, and I'm desperately trying to work with folks, for example, in the NHS in the United Kingdom, national healthcare system there. I would love to work with any hospital system in the US to solve this crisis, I think, of sleep in the hospital environment. But to come back to your point, this is a great experiment to do. You know, is exercise-induced acute inflammation, and is sort of, you know, heat shock sensitive,
yeah.
you know, induction of immune responses by way of saunas or hot baths, are those yeah. a pathway triggering good sleep? And if so, can we find novel therapeutics
right.
for, you know,
I should. I'll put you in touch with Dr. Jari Laukkanen too. He's in Finland. He's like the leading researcher on saunas. And
has he done some of the stuff on longevity?
He's all the saunas? He's the guy doing all the longevity, Alzheimer's disease, cardiovascular disease. And he's a friend of mine as well. So I'll put you in touch with him because that would be really cool if you guys could.
If we can start tracking their sleep,
right?
You know, and see that perhaps, and you can sort of put this into a statistical sort of triangulation, which is called a mediation analysis, and you could see, you know, what's causing that longevity benefit? Because we know, for example, that the shorter your sleep, the shorter your life. That short sleep predicts all-cause mortality. It's also probably one of the most significant lifestyle factors determining whether or not you'll develop Alzheimer's disease. And all of these things I know have been linked to, for example, sauna use, which is longevity, decreased susceptibility to development of dementia and cognitive decline, is part of that. I'm not trying to say it's all about sleep. But
you know,
part of it
really,
sleep.
You know, I've been, one of my major interests is aging, increasing health span, as well as performance without the trade-off.
Yeah.
And every time I always come back to sleep. The studies, I mean, it's just constantly coming back in my face how important sleep is for all of those things.
And it's the superordinate lever that transacts all health benefits. You know, it's the tide that rises all of the health boats. And I think it's wonderful that folks, you know, here in Silicon Valley are going after, you know, individual pathways of disease, trying to manipulate, you know, immune pathways or trying to manipulate mTOR for sort of, you know, longevity. But I think what's been missing in this equation is that there is, you know, an Archimedes lever here. There is one superordinate node that if you pull that lever, all of the other pathways are instigated and activated, and that superordinate node or lever is this thing called sleep.
Right.
You know, there is no physiological system that we've been able to measure that isn't wonderfully enhanced by sleep when you get it or demonstrably impaired when you don't get enough.
Right.